Dr. Madiha,
Hello, how
I'm good. Can you hear me?
you, Maha? Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, we're just checking if the connection is right. Yes. So it's all good from your end. Yes.
Yes, I
Yes.
can hear
Dr.
you.
Madiha, Dr. Madiha, your angle is a bit other way. So if you go the portrait way, yes, please. Yes, that's better. Okay, Dr. Malia, thank you so much for doing this with us and welcome to the live session. And if you could please introduce yourself to our audience, who you are and what you do, we would be grateful. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Madhu Malik and I'm the CEO of Syntex Health Project. And recently we are, it's basically Syntex Health Project is a CRO and a corporate firm. We have launched different initiatives like our skincare brand with the name of Mandi Organics, which is an organic skincare, haircare, and cosmetic brand. Besides this, we have also launched Eating Disorder Association of Pakistan, the first one in the Southeast Asian region, and I'm also the president of Pakistan Eating Disorder Association of Pakistan. And besides this, I'm a researcher, healthcare professional, gender equity advocate, and also the alumni of U.S. State Department.
Thank you, Dr. Madhika. And you have a body positivity fashion show coming up. So this is what our focus and aim is to speak about the show today. So if you could please tell us more about the fashion show.
Yeah, sure. Actually, I won a funding, a seed funding competition, which was organized by the U.S. State Department. And for that, I launched a brand with the name Dhaga, which was a print wear, and we used to, customize the clothing for sizes of all women, children, and men. And while doing so, we also provided free screening services for eating disorder to our customers. So actually, it started from there. And then at that time, with the help of that funding, we were able to basically the first body positivity support program and eating disorder advocacy campaign for Pakistan. And we organized our first fashion show using real women and men, as well as children, as models for promoting body positivity through taking fashion as a tool. So that was back last year in 2022. So this year, we are going to organize our second fashion runway, and we are going huge this time. We have different international partners with us. We are actually launching our first eating disorder report from the Southeast Asian region with the help of Academy of Eating Disorder, US. And besides this, we are also signing MOU with the three different organizations in Pakistan. One of the organization is American Lysitas, which is a very well-known brand. That is a chain for schools, and we are starting our campaign for promote for eating disorder advocacy and promotion of body positivity in their 80 branches across Pakistan, using different resources for educating children as well as parents regarding eating disorder. So besides this, our next partner is Rainbow Medical Center, which is the only medical center treating eating disorder in Pakistan, as we do not have many experts for treating eating disorder in Pakistan. So they are coming as our partner. So probably we would be screening people and referring the screen people to eating to their center for further counseling and treatments, what sort of services they would be providing. And meanwhile, we're also planning to go big, and we are going to launch our helpline for eating disorder for Pakistan with them in coming future. And besides this, we have also taken our last but not the least, our third partner, Islamabad Women Chamber of Commerce and Industry as a body positivity supporting partner. And we have, in this fashion show, basically, we have taken emerging women entrepreneurs, their design, promoting body positivity for every body size, for every, you know, complexion, for everyone. Mm-hmm. And we have had different disorder through this fashion show, and Islamabad Women Chamber of Commerce and Industry are actually supporting us for this fashion show as our body positivity campaign in Pakistan.
So please tell us, you know, what fueled your interest in helping people with eating disorders, especially creating this movement and creating the awareness of this illness in Pakistan.
Actually, Maha, I'm also a researcher, and we have been, like, you know, working on this topic for the last 2 years. Unfortunately, we do not have any statistical data in Pakistan. Our mental health policy was updated back in 2005, and it's still not updated. So, you know, the eating disorder specifically is not included in our mental policy. And the problem is that body shaming is a very common phenomenon in Pakistan, and our media has a great influence and impact on the younger generation. And then, you know, there are certain stereotypes which are being attached with the complexion, with the body size, shape, and everything. So, and people do not like to talk about it. You know, if they are suffering in pain, like binge and anorexia are the most common, you know, diagnosed. Like, obviously, it is underreported in Pakistan because we do not have that screening services in Pakistan. So, but usually these two, you can say eating disorder are the most common reported in Pakistan. So, you know, people do not want to talk about it. People actually do not consider it a disorder. Because they do not have awareness about that. So through our campaign, advocacy campaign, we wanted to promote this concept that eating disorder are a disorder, it's not a choice. So just, you know, come forward, talk about it, get help, get screened, and get treated. And, you know, start accepting yourself and your body the way, you know, Allah has made you. And that is the first, you know, step towards starting a very body positive journey. We are also, launching our different games, you know, for promoting it. Sort of like we have Let's Talk. It's basically a card game which promotes awareness. It's just, it's on the type of a local game available in Pakistan. Oh no, we have replicated it in the form of eating, and, you know, to promote more advocacy. We are launching different comic books, stories. We are going with the games. So actually, we just want to, you know, we want to let people know what eating disorders are, how they can be treated. It's okay to talk about them. It should not be taken as a stereotype, and stop actually body shaming. So this is basically the idea behind all this advocacy campaign. And further, once this advocacy campaign is successful, we are literally planning to go for a policy dialogue. And we would really want to get this eating disorder included in our mental health policy of Pakistan.
So, Dr. Madhya, we have a population of 180 million plus. So how are you, I mean, planning on reaching the people, especially in the remote areas of Pakistan? Because let's be very, very honest, you know, this illness is more common among certain factions of society. It is widespread, but the people who are suffering more do belong to the certain sect of society. So it's not, you know, really prevailing. It's not really common everywhere else. Maybe the numbers are there, but maybe you will find in thousands, maybe one or two odd numbers. But, you know, so what is your policy? Are you aiming to focus on, you know, certain factions of society, or are you planning on reaching out to, like, people all over the Pakistan?
This is a very interesting question, and I totally agree with you, Maha. This is one of the issues in Pakistan. But, you know, 60% of the population of Pakistan actually resides in the rural area, so we cannot neglect them, and that's where the masses are. So actually, we have recently launched our app, which is available with the name of iMatter. That's the screening app, and it has all the connection that you can, you know, screen yourself. And if you are at the risk of eating disorder, our team get connected with you, and you know, they give you free awareness sessions, and then they get you connected with a treatment center. So that's the one way which we are using our app to screen more people to, you know, reach to masses. Besides this, one of the reasons for taking Islamabad Women Chamber of Commerce and Industry on board as our national advocacy partner is the idea that there are so many, women, as well as, you know, we are also taking the male chamber on board also, that there are so many, members which are registered in the chamber. So we are also using chambers for our advocacy model. Because like more than 10,000 people are registered in one chamber, and there are 21 chambers across Pakistan who are also targeting the rural area. Besides this, we're also planning to go for our advocacy campaigns in different schools. So we are starting with American Lifestyle, but we are planning to go huge, and we are going to take other schools on board also. Then we're also planning, you know, trainers of the training sessions for this. But the first of all, the most important thing for us is screen people. So we are actually in the first phase, we would be promoting more screening services, and once we are good with the numbers, then we are going to go in our next phase, and then definitely we are going to take more, you know, social sector, universities, colleges, schools, more government institutes, more, you know, healthcare centers with us as our partner. So that's the plan. So you see, let's how it rolls out.
So Dr. Madhya, do you think, you know, the country we are living in, this was the question someone said to me, they said, is it fair to, you know, utilize when we have so much poverty in our country, you know, when there are other very pressing health matters which really need taken care of. There are actually, you know, eating disorders kill, but then this is the illness which doesn't just need a short-term treatment, but it does need a long-term treatment. You really need to capture people's interest. You really need to engage people. You really need to make them understand what is happening. And that actually is going to involve a lot of money, a lot of cost, and then you have to come up with the treatment as well. And, you know, the average treatment, you know, that in America is like it's $1,000 a day. Minimum you're paying for an average session, you are paying $60 to $70, and now this is minimum for 20 minute session, you can pay up to $70. So, you know, here, I mean, how are we going to make everything work?
Actually, you are quite right, Maha. But you know, if like what we think and we envisage is that, you know, food is one of the major, you know, food is the only thing which is being talked the most about in Pakistan. So we were actually thinking that we are going to take media on board also. We are going to involve that. And for this, we are starting a series on our national radio, as well as on TV. I'm coming on one of the morning show, and I'm going to talk about it. And we are going to, you know, use, obviously media is one of the very important stakeholder in this movement. As far as you were saying about the fundings and the staff, we are looking for local investor funders as well as international funders. We are in the process of collaborating with them. We are talking about this. There are more than 600 pharma industry in Pakistan. So, you know, the money is there, the idea is there. We just pitch to the top pharma companies in Pakistan, and we are actually talking with them that, you know, we need more support to actually start the clinical trials, you know, just for the advocacy thing. And then they can also see that where it goes from there. I think there is a huge pharma industry in Pakistan, which are like, you know, more than $1.3 billion. Which could be utilized. And then there are community pharmacies. This is another area in Pakistan which are ready to, you know, offer different community services, and they have that fund for that particular thing. I don't think that we might be able to, you know, build a treatment center immediately in Pakistan, but we do have that in our plan for the next 10 years, but at least I know that we can have some funders, like, you know, sponsors, international sponsors as well as local sponsors who can support us in actually, you know, providing treatment. But what I think as a healthcare professional is it will not be valid until it is included in the policy. So that is one of the things when, you know, the healthcare budget allocation is done. So that's why we want to get it included in the mental health policy, that at least the policy makers or the budget allocators, whenever they sit, so they have this thing in mind that we really need to, you know, allocate some budget for these disorders also. So we are just trying, because, you know, we have to take the start from somewhere. I don't know where the pathway to that, but let's start the journey and see that where it goes. So these things, we are considering these things. We are talking to sponsors, investors, that we need money for this. So I don't assume that we will be thinking in the next 5 years, but I'm hopeful and I'm really confident that we will be able to have, like, at least one really good treatment center in the next 10 years in Pakistan. But for the time being, we are basically different portal where we can get them connected with online with our international healthcare experts who have actually come forward and who are supporting us. They would be, you know, they would be charging at a very minimum for the treatments. So we'll be starting from here and let's see where it goes.
You know, Dr. Madhya, because we are so late to join this whole initiative and whole campaign of, you know, creating awareness of eating disorders in Pakistan, I think we really need to learn from the, you know, the mistakes which have been made, you know, the previously in the countries where eating disorder was became very known for, like in 1980s, you know, the whole initiative kind of started with the Princess P and, you know, the others. And I think we really need to be very, very careful, because I think someone, what they said to me today was really right. I was in conversation with someone in UK and they said, you know, is it really like taking into account our country and our budget and everything to spend like, you know, £80,000 to £90,000 per person? And I said, no, I don't agree with that. But she said, so, you know, we need to be very, very smart. We need to see the relapse rates. We need to see what is not working in America, you know, in the countries with highest numbers of eating disorders, like, you know, the West. And then we need to see that, you know, we need to come up with something which is really unique, which is really going to benefit everyone, and which is not going to discriminate. Because, Dr. Madhya, pharmaceutical industry, these drugs are not the only answers. They are only there for, like, maybe few weeks or maybe maximum, and even they will not do anything, because this is related to something which you need to live, right? So you need to bring on board the whole team, and it is, unfortunately, it is and it will continue to be one of the most expensive illnesses to treat. So I think we have to be very, very smart, even when we put our motion forward to the government, and we do include it, because, you know, we don't just need to train people on the grassroots levels. We also need to train people on the higher level as well. So it is going to be a lot of hard work in coming years. Don't you agree?
I totally agree with this. One good thing is that funding for Pakistan from Europol Group, who actually develop health data sets for different countries, and they have, like, developed health data sets based on the population preferences for more than, like, you know, 70 countries around the world, and they are actually using that data logarithms to incorporate HTA systems and the budget allocation on based on the population preference. So, unfortunately, Pakistan was among those countries who do not have their health value data sets, and we used to, you know, do our health quality of life modeling on the basis of Thailand, because they are more closer to the population, to our population. So now we have developed, the good news is that we have been able to develop our own own Pakistani population-based health value dialysis, which we are going to pitch the government to be, you know, including those health value, using the data of those health value dialysis for budget allocation and for, you know, making the budget plan for the next 5 years. So even they can do that for 50 years when we are incorporating any HD or new, you know, any medicine or technology in Pakistan. And as well as it could be, you know, using that for health insurance system establishment and all that. So, you know, we are, recently we are, at present, we're also doing the health value dialysis for the youth. And I'm so happy to see that actually now the difference between the and the youth is this, that what the difference we are getting is that youth give preference to mental health. And actually they are realizing it, that this is the time to speak out, they need help, and they are ready to step forward. So I think that if we involve that segment and we can government of Pakistan, we might, on the planning commission, because we're all, I'm already working with them. So I'm sure that it won't be, you know, in the near future, but actually we be somewhere in the coming years where we would be able to actually envisage that how much budget actually the government need to spend on these kinds of treatment, and what is the priority, or based on the priority and preference of the population. So I think that in the coming year, it will be the one of the preferences, the topmost preference of the youth of Pakistan, as the percent of the population of Pakistan is the youth, like the data shows. So I think that in the coming year, it will be much easier to advocate about this cause. So we might have those, you know, the funders or the policy makers or different stakeholders who would be focusing on that. And you are very right that we need to learn from the other countries, that how they have actually, you know, incorporated this concept into their healthcare system. But again, we cannot compare ourselves with a very high intense resource setting countries where they have the resources and, you know, all those experts. We really need to build this system from the scratch. And for this, we need examples from those countries where, with their limited resources, what they are doing and how they are making that successful.
And Dr. Malia, when it comes to taking examples from these countries, we don't have many.
Yes.
We don't have many because they are not, you know, this is still one of the most underrated illnesses of our modern time. Whereas when we look at the stats now, that since the COVID-19, the number has gone really up, and the media has so much, you know, so much of the blame is on media. So, I mean, I personally don't use any of these social media apps because I'm only on Instagram. That's like not my choice, but I have to be. But do you have any experience with TikTok or, you know, any of those Snapchats or, you know, any of those apps? Do you, I mean, have you seen any of them? And are you aware of the content which is there? Do you think it is pressurizing our youth? Because the number which, you know, is getting diagnosed more, the number which is coming up more forward, you know, that is the number which is young people, impressionable young people.
So yes.
Do you have any opinion on TikTok culture?
Yes. I agree with you. 100% agree with you. Actually, I'm also not a very social media person, and I don't use any kind of the apps or something. This is my official account, which is being handled by my team. So I really don't know how to use it because I'm not very much. I'm not that social media person. But the influence and the impact of the social media on our youth, it's devastating. And along with that, the content of the movies or, you know, the dramas which are being shown, or the morning shows even, which are being shown on our national TV, different national TV stations, they actually put that pressure on the girls or even the boys now to look perfect. I'll just share an example with you. When I, you know, planned this fashion show, and I, you know, announced that we need real men and women who can, you know, come forward and just walk on the ramp, you know, irrespective of how they look, or, you know, just feeling themselves and be confident that they are beautiful. I I there were so many people whom I wanted them to walk, and they were scared. They felt cold defeated because they said, oh my God, you know, we can't do that. That people will judge us or they will criticize us. We look fat or we look, you know, we look so thin or we do not look beautiful or something like that. And 20% of those people were young people who were very much conscious about the look, that how they would be looking on the ramp, people would be judging them, or their, you know, the audience would be bullying them, or their friends might be, you know, making memes on them, or, you know, some that sort. And I was like, come on, it's just a body positivity fashion runway. It's okay, however you look, come forward and just, you know, break the stereotype, be yourself, be beautiful, it's fine. It's just a fashion show, a simple fashion show. It's not like, you know, a huge kind of or actual fashion show, but still people were having those issues in coming on the stage and just walking, you know, holding a tagline, a body positivity tagline. So from this, you can have an idea that how much impact the social media and these TikToker influencers have on their mind, that they have to look perfect, they have to look zero size, they have to look, you know, fair, they have to look like this, they have to look like this. So, you know, yes, I totally agree that the most, what I think is the most common reason for this kind of is one of the media is one of the reason for this. And actually, Maha, I would just like to add one more thing here. In our culture, like in the Asian culture, usually the Southeast Asian culture, the body shaming and bullying actually starts from the home. Our siblings, our uncle, mom, our parents even, they make such comments when we are kids. We as a female have to listen to, you know, so much negativity, so much criticism about our looks, about our body size, about our body shape. And then when it comes to marriage stuff, that's the worst part of it. 51% of the population of Pakistan are women, and they have to face this bullying and body shaming, because I don't know that even the guy does not look, the guy maybe looks like a giant, but he needs a very, you know, an Alyssa or a princess kind of wife. And that's the most important pressure which the females or the women in Pakistan and even in India, I was having a chat with one of my friends there. They are facing this thing. And that is the reason that if you just look at the percentage of unmarried women or even the divorce rate, it's so high in Pakistan. I was just sitting with a friend today and she was telling me that, you know, I had this binge eating when I was married. Now she's divorced. So she was just telling me because I had this from my husband and from my in-laws about my body. About my body size, you see. So we cannot ignore all these factors here, which are basically promoting this in Pakistan as well as in other countries.
I absolutely agree with you, because if you, you know, Dr. Madhya, as you said, you know, we need to let go of this body shaming culture. But, you know, what about, you know, these, we do have certain influencers. I mean, going back to you, the points you made, there was an influencer, she's a YouTuber, and she said, you know, she basically went to India to act. And she said, as soon as she got to India, her whole perception changed when she was going to work in Bollywood. I mean, all she was doing was research the content online on how to do the plastic surgery, how to look perfect. And she said it all became about her looks till she left, you know, Bollywood, and her life changed and she realized, you know, these things were not really, really right. So if we even look at our neighboring country, honestly, Dr. Madhya, they have the crisis on their hands, because the Bollywood industry is so like It's like completely. So this Bollywood industry is like really dominating people's lives, and people, you know, really take it that, you know, it's the truth, that, you know, this is what the industry is all about. This is what the life is all about. So what can we do to, you know, make people understand this is not a real life, this is not reality, and also how to stop our influencers from, you know, promoting this kind of thinking? And really, because it's really becoming self-beliefs now.
Actually, I think, Maha, to be very honest, it is very difficult to do so, because the fashion industry is one of the top industries in any country. So we cannot say that we are going to start what they do, because they make money on this. But now I think that awareness is coming in Pakistan, and some of the channels are working on social causes, and they are actually making different dramas and different movies on body shaming and that kind of culture. So I think the good things, there are also, like, I'll just not say that they are not they are just, you know, having that devastating effect on the youth or on the society. But now actually few of the channels are really have realized this thing, and they are working, and many brands even have come forward, and they are you know, promoting prettywear of every size, of every shape, and they are actually using you know, even big size women as their models, or very, you know, skinny women as their models. So I think that the revolution has started, but it will take some time to actually make people realize. But what I think is that the journey starts from inside. If I'm not going to accept my body, nobody else will. So we need to realize, and we need to promote this thing, that self-acceptance is the first step towards this body positivity journey. When you have accepted yourself, and you feel beautiful in your own self, but I don't think it matters actually that how I look, or, you know, what people will think about me, or what other thing. And, you know, I have also fought with this concept throughout my life, because when I was small, I used to have a lot of body shaming, and I used to listen so much bully taking you know, my looks or my you know, body size. I was like, the thing was that I realized that when you have other achievements on your plate, and when you actually ignore the people and focus on your career or on your life, and when you have a lot, you know, a lot of achievement on your plate, then these things goes in the background. So I think we need to promote this thing, because the other steps which we are talking, they will take time actually. We cannot educate or advocate the whole nation at once. We cannot build a, you know, treatment center in 1 or 2 days. We cannot change the mindset of the society. The best thing we need to do is to change ourselves, to accept ourselves. So I think that's the first point where we can start and see that how it goes on.
Thank you. But, you know, Dr. Madhya, you know, you're right. It is going to take time. But I think we really need to put some policies in place. Like, you know, for example, blasphemy, you know, we have certain comments, you know, which people cannot make under any circumstances. Like, you know, you're not allowed to make certain comments on media, or even when you're, you know, in a social gathering, it's not allowed. Same here. Human life is so sacred. Human heart is like a Kaaba, you know. So again, you know, you have no right to destroy someone's life, to make such comments, because these comments, I mean, what is media doing now? By the time they do get the awareness, it is going to be too late, because so many lives will be destroyed. And, you know, if we do study the cases in other countries, we have seen that, you know, by looking at certain people, by trying to be like them, people have gone to certain extremes, and, you know, we cannot allow that to happen anymore. And also, I think, you know, some of the morning shows, I mean, I really have, there is one morning show in our country, and honestly, the only the content they know, honestly, I'm being very honest, not just the host, even her team and her guests, is how to groom yourself, and the fat diets, and they promote so horrible diets, you know, which are not even scientifically proven. They always talk about the looks. They always talk about, you know, the first question the host asks all her guests is, oh, so, you know, tell me, how did you lose weight? So, you know, this is English. It's not just that, you know, she's asking the guests. She's also always talking about herself, and she thinks, you know, and, you know, she's someone who so many people are watching, and it's so frustrating because if when somebody forwards me their content, honestly, it borderline really, really upsets me because, you know, the mother will be like, but, you know, my daughter picked up this skill, you know, this tip from her. And why can't she be stopped? You know, why can't she just, you know, talk about something else? And, you know, this is something we have to do, Dr. Madhyani. You spoke about these labels, you know, which are promoting every size. I'm sorry, but, you know, it's not like, you know, that they want to promote every size. It's like they're being forced because of, you know, the consequences of, you know, what they were doing on the runway. I mean, if you look at the runway a few years back, every single model was one size, yeah? And, you know, we know about the abuse which was taking place in the fashion industry. So, you know, and it had a lot of consequences. So I think, you know, in Pakistan, few celebrities have come out. They have spoken about, you know, the body image, the eating disorders. But I really think, you know, we really need to get the scholars involved. And again, the dilemma is, yeah, when you speak to them, they're like, but, you know, people are dying of hunger. And here you're speaking about people are eating and eating and eating. And then they're like, but what kind of a... And honestly, this is something which is so difficult to explain. That no, they're, so why is she not eating? Why hasn't she eaten for 4 months? Because she wants to look thin. They said, but why? I said, why does she want to look thin? Is it, you know, her mother pressuring her? Is it her husband? Or why? And then I'm like, okay, you know, it's because their inspiration comes from. And then they give you one answer, you know, which is a very good answer. But, you know, you cannot do that. That is a sin. And, you know, this needs to be stopped. And I really do think that, you know, this whole thing has gone really far. And, you know, when you said, you know, we cannot look at the West because, you know, they do, they have developed, you know, very, very high because of the budget they had. So, you know, their treatment is according to their budget. But we also have to look at, I mean, recently I had someone in America, honestly, the insurance wouldn't cover her. So her father was paying $1,000 a day for her. And guess what? I mean, it wasn't really, really effective. So, you know, there are, I mean, no system, no program is 100% accurate. And we, you know, we can't allow ourselves to go to that stage where our families have to, you know, look for $70,000 to $80,000 for our treatment. So I think, you know, Dr. Madhya, we have a lot of hard work to do. And you're right, you know, this whole culture of body shaming, everything needs to stop. And we really need to look at, you know, we really need to look at the family structure and dynamics. Because I will be very honest, if one place a person can make full recovery is at the comfort of their home and with the support of their family. And we are very, very blessed because our family system in Pakistan is, in Asia, is very, very strong. So if we can really get the families involved, honestly, you've done 70% of the work at home. So Dr. Please go ahead.
I totally agree with you, Maha, and that is one of the reasons that we are also taking on board Islamic scholars from international Islamic university, and we are actually requesting them to, you know, include a few hadiths or, you know, Quranic ayahs or, you know, a few of those incidents from the Hazrat Muhammad life, and while they are giving lectures. And we actually held one conference on eating disorder in perspective of Islam in Pakistan, and we are planning to go with a series of such seminars as well as, you know, conferences to take more religious scholars on board also. So we are also working on that thing. But, you know, you are quite right with whatever assessment you have, and, you know, whatever analysis you have presented here. And that is one of the reasons that we are starting our advocacy campaign from schools. And we are basically educating parents and children. Because, you know, that's the right way of starting a thing. When parents are educated, they will actually give that enabling environment to their kids at their home. And then from there, you know, the confidence of the children and that environment. And actually, those parents need to stop their children, and they need to educate them that they have to stop bullying their friends or, you know, making fun of other kids in the school. And then we were planning to do, you know, health session for training of the trainers, the teachers. They can also play a very important role in educating children. And I think if we start this thing from the grassroots level, like, you know, from small kids, from the school level, I think much of the issue could be addressed easily. That's how I perceive this issue. Because you're right that we are quite late in Pakistan. Pakistan has 9,188 countries in diversity. So we really need to look at this. We really need to see that where we are standing, where we are heading. So we really need to promote a healthy lifestyle among the youth, among the people of Pakistan. And then they can also combat these eating disorder issue together in the country.
Because I tell you one thing, Dr. Madhya, if there is one illness which has the tendency to destroy the very fabric of not just the family but the society, then this is this illness. I remember I was in UK, I was in like, and there was a young girl, and trust me, she was diagnosed at the age of 9. She turned 16 and her mother basically had to give up nearly everything, and they simply couldn't win. The family couldn't win the battle against her eating disorder. You know, the school was involved. You know, they made sure the school was involved because she had to go to the school. Her meals were monitored. And it got to the point where the mother said, you know, she said to me, Maha, she said, you know, if my daughter at that time, I was suffering and, you know, she was sent to me to speak to me, you know, to put some wise words into my mind. So she's speaking to me and it was like she was speaking to a brick wall. And she said, you know, Maha, I swear, if my daughter gets to your age and she still has this illness, I swear I'll do something which I will later regret. So, you know, it showed me how severe the illness was and how, you know, we need to not just involve the families, Dr. Madhya, we need to involve the community, but the family, we also have to look at the carers. As I said, you know, Dr. Madhya, as you are going to do your research, because, you know, we used to have maybe 2-3 categories of eating disorder. Now, the whole eating disorder, you know, it has exploded. We have so many categories. We have eating disorders which do not even fit into any category. You know, they're not bulimia, they're not eating anorexia, you know, it's like, even I am baffled. And when I'm hearing about people, it really, really surprises me because I'm like, my God, you know, I never knew that this was a disorder which was taking place. Because as you know, the most common eating disorders people focus on are on anorexia. And even bulimia is hidden, you know, that is like pretty much hidden as well. But anorexia is like one of the one, you know, which when people look at it and people are like, yes. You know, we do have Aga Khan University Hospital in Pakistan. You know, they do treat, you know, eating disorders. You know, we have like this in Islamabad. You know, we do have a Shifa International, but again, it's very, very, very limited. It's, you know, for a very exclusive section of society. But whereas now, Dr. Madhya, I am getting people who do not even have $10, honestly. They don't even have $10 to spare. Like, you know, even for the basic consultation, you know, when I ask them, you know, you need to go for the consultation, it shocks me that they don't even have $5 or $10. So this is no longer the illness of, you know, certain set people. It's actually, it is spreading in our rural areas. And, you know, we really need to come up with something really, really fast. And I don't think so, you know, the psychiatric medicine, because what is happening, they are developing so many things alongside their eating disorder. They're becoming agoraphobic, they're developing an anxiety, you know, their social skills are like zero. And, you know, some of them are being diagnosed with, you know, BPD as well, which is bipolar personality disorder. I think that's where, you know, we really need to, and, you know, Dr. Madhya, we really need our government involved. They need to allocate a very, very good, you know, amount of funding to this illness. Because, you know, why we start now, we can really stop it. We can really stop it. So, you know, the money the government will invest, it's going to have a benefit. They will see the benefit in 10 years' time. because we can really stop, you know, this getting to the level where UK is at now. UK is can't handle it. USA could never handle this, and they're not handling it now. But UK, I'm shocked. NHS waiting list, Dr. Madhya. Even when you're dying, I mean, they are so burdened. And so I think this is where we need to get together. The government needs to get together. The communities need to get together. And we need to fight this. Because I think one of the strongest things about Pakistan is, yeah, you know, we don't really look at our government. Yes, let's be honest. We come together as a society, and we always have. So, you know, even when it was COVID, you know, we were one of the countries which did well because, you know, why? Because we came together. We were not looking at our governments for the handouts. And I think this is, you know, what we need to promote. We need to come together as a society, get many people involved, even if the organizations, you know, don't want to get involved, you know, even they have nothing to do with their body positivity or health. They still need to get involved, you know, for the humanitarian sake, you know, for the sake of on the basis of compassion. Because I'm being very honest here, Dr. Madhya, the way the cases are coming my way, I am like, my God, I think, you know what, if we don't take the action now, yeah, this is just going to go out of hands.
Yes, very true. I totally agree with you. But the thing is that now the question is that our president of Pakistan, Dr. Arif Elvi, because he's also a healthcare professional himself, so he is now revising our mental health policy, and we are working with him in close contact. And I have the chance to meet the group which I work, the expert group who is working on the you know, the mental health policy, Dr. Nusrat, and I just talked to him, I spoke to him, and I told him that, you see, you really need to look at these mental disorders, eating disorders, because we are suffering. We need to really see that how we can incorporate our eating disorder, you know, into our mental health policy, and how we can, you know, allocate the budget for them, or at least, you know, do something for the advocacy, at least how government can help us with this. So it's not like, you know, I know things move slow in Pakistan, just like any other country at the level of the government. And you are very right that as a nation, we always stood up together to, you know, fight for a cause. But the good thing is that we're also taking the government on board. And now I think we can at least, you know, raise the voice. We can just chip in like, hey, you know, this is also an issue to talk about. So we are almost there. So I think that I'm hopeful that more, we're engaging more youth with us. Like, they are becoming our ambassadors. So you are very right that we as a community, we as a nation need to, you know, educate other people and, you know, just, you know, So let's see that how well it goes from there. But I think, you know, I'm satisfied that I've taken that step, and somebody has come forward and actually, you know, started something where, like, you know, all the drops can come together. And then maybe we would be able to take a giant leap. So it's just
Inshallah, yes. No, Dr. Madhya, you really, really have done really well. And, you know, I really have to congratulate you on setting up Eating Disorder Association of Pakistan. And also, you know, this body positivity, you know, I mean, you know, we need to come up with unique ways of promoting this, you know, this cause. And, you know, we need unique ways for creating awareness. And, you know, you are, hats off to you, you and your team, you are doing it, you know, you're completely on board. And I know, you know, inshallah, you know, that the research, which is going to come from us and our country, you know, we have so much potential. Even, you know, I'm you know, here one like the cost of a therapy is like $10. Yes, you know, and you know, even the day program can cost, you know, $75 a day, and in America it's costing like $1,000 a day. So I really, you know, have a lot of hope, and I really do think that, you know, your team is going to do some really good research, and it is going to be a unique research. So please, 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 you know, keep, we need a lot of research here, Dr. Madhya, and not just, you know, with the anorexia and bulimia, you know, you need to look at every single category, and we need to focus on not just, you know, the young adolescents, we need to focus on middle-aged women, we need to focus on, you know, people who have gone through the divorce, we have, you know, we have so much catching up to do, and we need to get the universities involved, encourage our, you know, people who are doing masters and bachelors in psychology to please, you know, to take on these research topics so we can create more awareness, so we can feed it into the system, and so more people can know. Because in the, I was speaking to someone from the university in Islamabad, and I said, so, you know, what is your research topic? And I said, why not eating disorders? And she was sure. She said to me, but we haven't covered it. We don't know anything about it. And she was telling me the limitations. And I said, you know, so this is something we need to do. Really encourage universities, every university in, you know, whether it's in Islamabad, Pakistan, Karachi, that, you know, at least once a year, yeah, they need to produce some kind of a research on eating disorders. Because as I said, you know, it's no longer an anorexia, bulimia, or binging eating disorder, or, you know, it's pregorexia. There is so much, Dr. Madhya, that everybody needs to come together, and every university has to take the responsibility of producing some kind of a research paper every year. Yes.
You're very right, Maha. We also, you know, we also have this plan to come in contact with the gyms and the diet clinics, and we're also looking forward to, you know, conduct a research on bigorexia. And besides this, we're also planning another paper on orthorexia. And then we are not forgetting our little kids, and we're also planning one of the research on PICA. One of the problem in Pakistan is also the lack of evidence-based data. So we are just not doing the advocacy part. We're also focusing on the research part to actually produce that evidence-based data, you know, the prevalence data on the which we can, you know, design some interventions. It could be more useful and successful and fruitful to actually combat the disease. So I totally agree with you. I really need to come with the more research to produce more evidence-based data. And actually to then to come, you know, first to provide that baseline data, and then to actually develop some good interventional schemes. But how we can, you know, actually help, like, we do not have those treatment centers, but still we can have some good CBT therapies or other mode of, you know, counseling techniques where we can use them and have some good intervention studies, like, you know, learning from the experiences of other countries. And we are doing one paper on that. So I hope that in the next year, in the next 5 years, we can actually set our research agenda also, that how we are going to, you know, lead this cause ahead. And one of the things I would just like to add, that, you know, Maha, when I started this research, and the credit goes to you, because you was the one who actually came to Pakistan, you met, and you actually, you know, discussed this thing with me, and then we started, you know, working on this agenda. So when I was meeting with people, and when I was doing one of my research, so people were also, we need to actually change the perception. We need to change the mindset. And the most difficult thing is to change the mindset. So when you were talking with them that, you know, they want to look beautiful or something, so they were also always saying this, that, you know, we use these certain kind of, like skincare products or the cosmetics to look beautiful. So we actually realized at that point that, you know, it's not only enough to educate them. We also have to provide an alternative to, you know, these people to change that mindset, that they have to use some product. So we went back to nature. So we actually did, our team did a R&D for like last 2 years. And we actually launched 59 organic products as an alternative to these products, so they can use them. And if, like, they have to satisfy themselves that they are using, you know, some product to look beautiful, so it's a natural way of doing that. That's the more healthier, you know, free of parabens, free of toxic effects, free of chemicals. And that was the point where we realized that it actually start helping. Because when we were promoting our organic product, the first comment I remember I got on my project was, oh, it does not smell nice. So I said, yes, because it's organic, it's natural. It does not have any, you know, chemicals or parabens or toxic materials in it, but it is safe to use. It may not give you a very fair skin. It may not, you know, change your skin type, but it will give you a healthier look. It will, and when you will have that healthier skin, you will automatically look beautiful. And that's the confidence which you need to have. So, you know, it took like 2 years in a... promoting these products and even promoting this advocacy campaign to actually make the customer accept that nature also work, because it will not work fast. It's not a, you know, a magical thing that you will apply something and it will change your color or your skin texture overnight. You see, so we tell them that you need to go slow. You need to take care, have a good healthy skincare regime. You're just taking care of yourself in a healthier manner using the nature as an alternative.
Thank you, Dr. Madhya. Thank you so much for your time, and thank you so much for doing this fashion show on such a day. I mean, I am really looking forward to it, and I know so many other people are too looking forward to it. I mean, we were supposed to have a lot of people join us for this fashion show, but because of, you know, certain problems and, you know, certain things have gotten in the way. But I'm hoping, you know, inshallah, the next fashion show we have, we will have more people. We can include more people, you know, from all over the world. And
we're also live streaming our show, so if any of your audience or if any of your followers would like to join us, you know, remotely, they and support campaign, support our advocacy, so please be part of that.
Yes, and once again, Dr. Madhya, thank you so much. And I know you will be doing a lot of research in forward in future. So inshallah, I really look forward to it. So thank you for, you know, doing this work. You know, we have to start from somewhere and we have to make some kind of a noise. I know it's very difficult, but, you know, inshallah, you know, we will get there. And I know we will not allow this thing to become a pandemic in our country. You know, we will stop it, and we will also be, you know, spreading our campaign, not just into our country, but into other Muslim countries as well. As you know, that, you know, my work is not limited to Pakistan. I mean, even though I'm here, but, you know, it is, I mean, it is to do with the Muslim world. And, you know, I am dealing with the cases from all over the Muslim world. So inshallah, you know, my aim is, yeah, for every single Muslim country to get on board, to recognize this illness, and, you know, to exercise the measures which can prevent and which will spread this illness from going far, inshallah. Thank you. I think we have lost her. Okay, so we will, we lost you for a second. So Dr. Madhya, I would like you to close this session with giving out a message, please.
Yes, I would first of all thank you for having me here today, and, you know, giving me this amazing platform to share my thoughts and, you know, share the small steps which we are taking in Pakistan to actually promote body positivity and combat eating disorder. And besides this, I would just like to say one thing: please accept yourself as you are. And we believe in a tagline which I always share with everyone, that please be yourself, be beautiful. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Madhya. Thank you so much. Okay, we will be signing off, and we would like to thank everyone who has joined us today. Thank you so much. And, you know, I'm so sorry we couldn't respond to your comments or anything, because, you know, we wanted you to listen to us. Otherwise, it would have been distracting. But I really want to thank everyone, because I know the time difference, you know, between the UK, USA, Canada, and all these countries is huge. But thank you so much for always supporting us, for always being there for us. Please do check out, you know, their social Instagram. I will be tagging Dr. Madhya, and please do visit our website. And please, before you all go, please do support the cause of Turkey and Syria. You know, we've always worked for Turkey and Syria since 2015. They really need us. Okay, so thank you so much. So we are signing off. Goodbye. Take care. Have a great weekend, everyone. Thank you. Bye.
Okay, bye.